The opinions and views expressed in the following presentation do not necessarily reflect those of GameCon Radio or its affiliates.
Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We rock your world. Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We rock your world. Tonight we've got a double header of guests. I first want to welcome people on the chat page, and I also want to welcome people that are listening via players. We don't often see them, and sometimes we forget that there are people listening using iTunes and using different kind of medias to listen to the show. Thank you so much for your support. We have a great show tonight. Norine Dresser is on. She's a author. She's a folklorist. And we're going to have some fun talking to her about saying goodbye, which is not going to be sad at all. Her book, I got her book, and it actually, there are some very, very cool stories in there. And each chapter of the book opens with a bit of a funny story. So Norine is an expert on death in cultures. So we're going to really enjoy this first hour. Then at 11, Chad Hopkins is going to come talk to us about Lyndhurst Estate in New York. By Tarry Town. It's in Tarry Town, and it's shadowed past. It's a wonderful, wonderful time capsule, and it has a big, huge Halloween thing going on. And again, welcome to people that are in the chat and listening to the players. Tonight, we're having the second presidential debate. I did not watch it because I want to wait tomorrow and watch the whole thing for myself. I just want to remind people that voting is your right as an American. It's a privilege, and it's also a responsibility, because you really need to think of who you're going to elect. Presidents, people that run for the presidency, one thing hasn't changed since the first presidential race after George Washington. You've got people who think they can do a good job. They think they have the answers. And you have to weed through a lot of the jargon and the usual, I don't know, whatever you want to call it, rhetoric that these people use, because obviously they want your vote, and they're going to tell you things you want to hear. And the reality of it is, a president can only do what their cabinet, what our senators and representatives let them do. They can't just walk out and do anything they want. So when policies don't go through and policies are changed or completely thrown to the wayside, it's not always your president that's responsible for this. There's a food chain. He's just the guy at the head, but he does not vote for all these things. He can veto. He does have certain powers, but he's not God. So use your brain and start listening to the real issues, and you know, vote in accordance to what you think is right. And remember, the United States is not a democracy. It has never been a democracy. It was not designed as a democracy. It is a republic. And I really ask people to look up government structure, what a republic is, what a democracy is, because the United States has always been built on capitalism. Even when George Washington and all the colonies were fighting, it was about money. So when you're listening to these debates, educate yourself so you know who you're voting for and why you're voting for them. And make sure you understand that your vote is going to mean something. We've got some crazy but news, which I thought would lighten mood tonight. Thank you. The mood tonight. And one of the things is Gary McKenna, back in February 2001, over 7 months, he had attacked American computers in our Pentagon, and he accessed 97 computers in 13 months, leaving thousands of user accounts inoperable and shutting down the network for 2,000 computers in Washington for 24 hours. And there's been this big fight that the United States wants to bring him over here to stand trial for espionage. And he's had his supporters in England who have said, no, we don't want him to go over there because we're afraid you're going to use a death penalty on him. Well, today he got some good news. The British government is not going to send him here to the United States to face us. I got to tell you something. I'm a little worried about the guy because this means England has to step up to the plate. And they have to send a message here to their own people saying, we will not tolerate this. So he might have been better off if he came to the United States, because the worst we would have done is sent him to Leavenworth or something, or make him start working for us. But over there in England, he may have a rough time. So, good luck, Gary, but please... people, stop hacking our computers. Boston tonight at 7:12 had a 4.5 earthquake, which was felt in Maine. I saw on Facebook a lot of my friends were saying, "Did anybody feel that? Did anybody feel that?" It's getting more common for us to get these small earthquakes and stuff like that. So. Everybody calm down. It wasn't a big one, but I always tell people, have a bag ready with your medicines, your important papers, your animals, important things that you need for them, in case you have to get out of your home because Mother Nature has other plans for you. So always be prepared. Our last story is a man carrying an arsenal of weapons had murder instructions on his computer. This guy, Yungda Hung Harris, is considered a flight risk. He was caught with various items in a trying to board a plane, a suitcase. He had duct tapes, billy clubs, biohazard suits, smoke grenade, different kinds of weapons, an axe, knife, handcuffs, but he said he wasn't up to anything bad, but he had different kinds of papers telling him how to kill and do all kinds of things wrong, and he's shocked that he's going to have to face criminal and psychological consequences for this. If you get on a plane looking like you're ready for war, somebody's going to look at you and say, all right, somebody arrest this guy. I don't know what he was thinking, but I'm happy that this guy is under arrest, because I'm going to Ireland and I don't want people like him on the plane with me. So that's your crazy but news. I want to go straight to our guest tonight, Norine Dresser, who has a book out, Saying Goodbye to Someone You Love, Your Emotional Journey Through the End of Life and Grief. And welcome to the lair, Norine.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me.
Thank you for coming on. At first, I thought the book would be very depressing. But it wasn't. It wasn't depressing at all. You talk a lot about different cultures and the way we deal with death. And I'm from an Irish family, so you know what that means. I was raised
going
to wakes.
You're having the wakes after the death?
3 days of wakes. And then kissing them goodbye. You know, you're a four-year-old child. Here, Chris, kiss her goodbye. Kiss him goodbye. You know, in the United States especially, I've seen a more clinical way of dealing with death now that I think has handicapped us. What do you think?
Oh, I totally agree. I think we've made death so separate from living, and it builds up a lot of fear. And I was raised in a family where we never talked about death. You know, if somebody died, an older person, you know, I would hear about it, but death was like a taboo topic. And I come from a Jewish family, so that also meant that when I was a young adult and pregnant with my children, when my grandparents died, I wasn't allowed to go to the funeral because it would mark the baby and things like that. So by the time I went to my first funeral, I was pregnant again and in my early 20s, and I nearly passed out. It was because I had built up such apprehension about death. But in the 1970s, I was teaching in the California State University system, and I lived in L.A. at the time. And in East L.A., they were celebrating Day of the Dead, and I went for the first time. And as soon as I saw how that particular culture, Latin American culture, treated death, I realized this is so much healthier because it allowed children to play with toy skulls. I got a big kick out of them. There was a life-size coffin made out of cardboard, and there was a string to pull at the bottom of it. So the kids would go up and pull it, and then up popped a skeleton from the top half of the coffin. Well, they kept going back and doing it over and over because it was a lot of fun. And I just felt that it was so much healthier to become accustomed to not only touching and playing with the artifacts of death, but also to visit a grave, not when somebody has just died and you're just filled with such pain, but just on an annual basis to go and clean the grave and decorate it. And as soon as I began seeing how Mexican Americans dealt with death, I changed my entire attitude about it. And when my husband and I were married, he would often say, "If I die," and then I would say, "If," and then by the time he was ready to die, you know, he would say, "When I die." Well, that seems like just a small change from if to when, but it's a huge paradigm shift, because you've then accepted it, and it's going to happen. Nobody gets out of here alive, so it's just a matter of the when. And so I probably the greatest learning experience of my life, and I have advanced degrees, is when my husband was termed terminal, and he stayed home in home hospice care for a year, and I took care of him. And that's where I really learned about dying and death and how important it is, and you don't have to be terminal, but how important it is to celebrate every day, even when you're dying. And as an example of that, when he came home and was in home hospice, we had the whole setup there with a hospital bed and the oxygen and all of that business. And family and neighbors came to call and see how he was and to bring him things. And since he wasn't experiencing any pain until the very, very end, you know, we would visit and I'd serve food, and then, or they would bring food. And I would say to him, when, if Harold is here by his 85th birthday, we're going to have a big party. Well, it was not a very diplomatic way to put it. You know, honey, if you're still here, we'll have a party. But I've not been too diplomatic all through my life. And so he was used to me. And so on his 85th birthday, we had over 100 people, and we went to the local park. And a relative of through marriage called me beforehand and said, would it be all right as a surprise for Harold to have a belly dancer there? And I said, oh, sure, not giving it too much thought. And on the day of the big event, my husband got overwhelmed with emotion when his little grandson showed up at the house, and he called me in and he said, I can't go through with this birthday picnic. And I said, well, I'll tell you what, let's try, and if you can't handle it, then I'll see that someone brings you home early. So he agreed to that. And they literally had to carry him up the stairs to the level part of the park. And he looked terrible, and he was all sunken in, and, you know, and people were sort of in that mood, we've come to say goodbye to him. And then suddenly the belly dancing music starts, and the belly dancer, very beautiful 21-year-old with a gorgeous 21-year-old body, comes, you know, dancing up to him. And guess what? He became, resuscitated. in a way he was. He became transformed. And there he was with his cane that he was leaning on. He pushed himself out of the chair, and he began dancing with her. And we were all laughing so hard. And it was just such a magical moment. And it proved to me that, you know, he didn't have to be sad to say goodbye. He could still have a good time. He could even dance. And in this case, the cane that he was leaning on became like a cane that Fred Astaire would use, you know, above his head with two hands.
I watched the video. It's hysterical.
Yes, and, I mean, it was fantastic. And that gave him so much energy. I know it prolonged his life. Because when he came home, he was the last one to leave the party, by the way. When the whole family was piled into the kitchen, my daughter came in and said, Dad, where's the snake? The toilet and the little bathroom's plugged up. He said, oh, get the snake. It's in the garage, and I'll fix it. And so we all kind of looked. He's going to fix this plugged-up toilet. Sure enough, he did. He was wired for months. And it was, people used to joke and say, forget the weekly visits from the social worker, book the belly dancer.
It is.
So, I mean, you know, it's sad. It's sad to say goodbye, but it was wonderful at the same time, because when the last 8 hours of his life, when we knew that this was the end, my daughter drove in with her two sons from Las Vegas. My son came up. My other daughter was there. The grandchildren were in the living room, and they all went in to see him. And I became a teacher at that point. I want you all to go in and say goodbye to your grandfather. And so they all went in. I didn't want them to be afraid of someone who was dying. And so they all went in, and then after the moment of death, I asked them, I said, I'd like you to go in and see Papa one last time. And all but one of them agreed to do it. And again, I felt it was really important psychologically for them not to be fearful. What does a dead person look like? Usually the casket is closed at most funerals. Not at Irish funerals, I know, but no, I know, and people kiss the corpse and all that. But I felt it was an important learning lesson for them.
Let me interrupt for a second. I have a historian friend, Al Sabalane, who is quite an expert on funerals and, you know, how it evolved with embalming and everything and
yeah.
The United States, And we were saying that it's become so clinical now that in many cases you don't even see the person, especially children won't see them because they're in hospital. And of course, you're told, well, children can't come in and, you know, that kind of thing. So there's that period where, you know, it could be months or even a year or more between when a child sees that person and then they're dead.
Never again. Yeah. It's really bad. That's why I was so keen on them seeing him at the end. And as a matter of fact, a close friend of mine died, 10 years ago, and he had two daughters, and we were on the West Coast, and he was affiliated with my university, and his daughters lived on the East Coast, and they came out for the funeral, and they didn't want to, you know, there's that law, at least in California, that somebody has to identify the body inside of the casket. Neither daughter wanted to see him. So I went with another good friend of his, and we were there to open the casket and ID him. And we kissed him goodbye. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there's too much fear.
I don't know. Maybe it's because of all the garbage. Because this all started with, like, the movies of the 50s, where dead people could get up and walk around after they'd been embalmed and everything like that.
Oh, yeah.
Know? And I really, honest to God, think that there are adults who have carried this over with them, thinking that it is possible for an embalmed body, you know, somebody who's been embalmed, to get up and walk around and stuff. I think that that culture of TV and movies somehow has kind of blurred the reality line on death, you know. My friend, she passed away a couple of years ago, Karen, but we were at her grandmother's funeral, and they were all Italian and Irish, and so all the kiddies were in their dresses and their suits and their patent leather shoes, and they were like dragging their feet across the rug in the room, and they would go up to Flossie's casket, and then they would touch her hair and watch the light, the static light her hair in the coffin.
Yeah, that's a whole lot better.
Yeah, it actually was hysterical because they thought that was Flossie. That's their great grandma. That's nobody.
That's right.
You know, and yet I see people now, and they don't do anything because now the person dies in a hospice or in the hospital, and the hospital will call you and say, I'm so sorry, you know, Mo has just dropped dead on us. And then they have the undertaker come and get them, and you have no contact with this body. You don't dress it. You don't do anything.
Right.
And then the next time you see them, so when my friend Karen passed away, she was having a stent put in her heart, and she died during it. So her sisters went into the funeral parlor, and of course they had the hairdresser took care of Karen and everything.
Oh, yeah.
But when Dawn walked in there, she had a heart attack. She says, Karen wouldn't be caught dead like this, you know? So they quit before the rest of the people got there. They took her hair and they got mousse and they were doing everything with her hair and everything. And this guy is like, we worked 4 hours on this, you know? And they're putting their makeup on and everything. But that's because that's the way we were raised.
That's right.
And, now,
and I think it's much healthier.
And now people aren't like that anymore. It's like, no, I could never touch them.
Yeah. You know, one of the things I learned in writing the book, I was so compelled to share the information with everybody because that's sort of my style. I'm always the teacher. And I found someone who was in the grief counseling profession, and we worked on the book together afterwards. One of the things I learned that I would do differently is, for some reason, when he died, I had stepped out of the room and my son was massaging his feet, and when I came back, he said, I think Dad took his last breath. And then the nurse came and confirmed that that was true. And I felt compelled, and actually she did it for me. She said, let me call the mortuary for you. What I have learned is what there is no rush to call the mortuary and have them remove the body from the house. That's the one thing I would do differently. I would have spent a little bit more time with him before, but I don't know why. I felt I had to rush and get him, get the, that process started. And there's really no reason to. My son was there and the undertakers arrived and my son said, you know, my wife is on the freeway right now on her way with my daughter and I didn't want to tell her until she got here. So do you mind waiting? And they said, no, not, of course not. But of course when she pulled up and saw the hearse, she knew. But, you know, that's one thing I would encourage people if someone dies at home. You don't have to rush right away. There's no rules about that. But I'm personally a very time-compulsive person. I thought, oh, well, I have to get on with the next step. But no, I should have just spent a little bit more time, and I think it would have helped a little bit.
Mm-hmm. When my mother passed away, she passed away in her sleep at night, and I had knee replacement. So we drove up to the house, which every day after physical therapy, I would go right to her house, and I saw the light on the porch, and I went, uh-oh. You know, my mother was up at clockwork, and she had the light off, and we were actually going to go for all the things we needed for the St. Patrick's Day party, you know, and the dinner and all, and so I couldn't get into the house because she had special locks on the inside, and finally the police climbed through the window and found her and everything. But what we did was we ended up with they had to wait to get it cleared to have the body moved and all, and my brother read a letter that she had put in her box. And she was apologizing for not leaving more money and everything. And I was just so devastated. And I went in the bedroom and I knelt by her and I grabbed her hand and I said, don't you ever, ever apologize for anything. You did wonderful. You know, I had that time that I felt she understood. You did the best damn job you could, lady. You know, and for being immigrants and coming off of out of Ireland and coming to a country where you didn't even speak the freaking language, you did wonderful. Don't you be apologizing for this stuff, you know? And I don't think families have that time because it's wham, bam, now you're at the funeral parlor.
Yeah,
you're planning everything and you're standing there getting told, well, the insurance isn't going to cover this and this isn't going to get covered and this isn't going to get covered.
Yeah.
And it kind of blurs it. When we have to go to break, when we come back, even though you are a cultural expert at death in different countries and everything, you were blindsided by this as well and had to deal with the loss after the fact. As you said, you kind of were like, okay, they're coming to get the body. Okay, goodbye. You know, everybody, let's just get it moving. You still had to deal with a lot, and then it kind of caught up with you. And I want to talk about that and some of the more healthy ways that and things we need to do so we're not caught at the end like that. We're going to be right back from the commercial, and the first song we're going to be playing is The Headless Horseman, Sleepy Hollow, Bing Crosby, because The Headless Horseman is my favorite Halloween character, and I just wanted to share that the Dullahan in Ireland is an old legend, much older than the Headless Horseman. And it's said in Ireland that the Dullahan rides a black stallion across the countryside. Clad in flowing black robes, he has no head on his shoulders. He carries his head in his hand, not a pumpkin. He's endowed with a supernatural light, and he will hold the head up high above him. And if the eyes of the head can see you in the distance, he'll head towards you. And if he stops by you, you die. and your soul is taken. So that's one of the Irish ghosties, and that's what I was raised on, the Dullahan. And then, of course, you had the Headless Horseman of Sleepy Hollow, which became famous again by Walt Disney. So we're going to be right back with Norine Dresser and talking about death in culture and ways to minimize the impact and not enjoy it, but come to grips with it and realize it's all part of life. We'll be right back.
Just a reminder, guys, all our talk show hosts here at GameCon Radio volunteer their time, but you can always show your appreciation. Click on the tip jar and give them a little love. I'm sure maybe your predictions will come out a little bit better. And that's how we roll here at GameCon Radio. We rock your game and your paranormal.
This is Michelle Tomlinson, the Scream Queen, and I listen to GameCon Radio. Why? Because it rocks!
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameCon Radio. And our guest tonight, our first guest for the evening, Norine Dresser. And we're talking about her book, Saying Goodbye to Someone You Love. And it is not a sad book by any stretch of the imagination. Norine, you ended up, you went through the illness with your husband, and like you said, you know, we're not meant to live forever. So when somebody starts getting up there in years and the body starts to fail you know that you're going to pass away. But even knowing all of this, you ended up having to deal with, like, kind of like having jet lag on the grieving process?
Definitely, because he was ill for a year and I was his primary caregiver, I put everything on hold. I was like tunnel vision. My every day was all consuming, just taking care of him and being on top of his meds, and I didn't trust anybody to do that but myself. And so when it was over, as I say, and I had that silly feeling of having to rush to call the mortuary, and then being Jewish, we have to have the funeral very quickly because we have no embalming. So he died on a Friday, and Saturday is the Sabbath, so there's no funeral allowed. And on Sunday, they were all booked up, so we didn't have it till Monday. And this was kind of funny because I said to him, you know, the first thing I'm going to do, because I had to talk about it with him, the first thing I'm going to do after you die, and he said, what? And I said, I'm going to get rid of your clothes, because he was such a pack rat. I had no room in the closets for my clothes. So by saying that to him, and he would just say, oh, you know, he would moan and groan. I said, that's the first thing I'm going to do. And so the funeral was on Monday. And on Tuesday, I had my kids help me get his clothes together. And on Wednesday, a charity came and picked up his clothes. I had to do that. I did major house repairs. And I even had my shoulder replaced because I was in terrible pain. I'm I have severe arthritis, and so I have three replaced joints. But so I took care of all that, and so now I'm up to December, and then the big, then it really hit me, because my to-do list was all taken care of. And then, now what? And so I have the two daughters, and one daughter said, have you thought about grief therapy? And I decided I would do that. And my other daughter said, why don't you get a cat, because they're low maintenance. Well, after Harold died, I got Tommy from the shelter. He has been the most expensive cat. Cause
I know, I read.
And but, of course, I adore him, and he helped me get over it. Just, you know, it's real easy to just say, oh, there's, what do I have to, I don't have to get up this morning. I can spend the day in bed. But no, you can't, because he won't let me. I have to get up and I have to give him his food. I have to make sure that there's food on hand, and I have to take him to the vet, and I have to clean the litter box and all of that. And it just keeps you going.
Yeah, and the pee off the rug.
Yeah, well, I've moved to a new state, and there's no rugs. It's all tile floor here.
You know, that's times when you say, why didn't you keep your mouth shut, child? But in a very true way, he helped you redirect your thought process.
Oh, yes. Well, and also the writing of the book. Because the writing of the book, although it was painful many times to have to go over the nitty-gritty of the whole process, it was therapeutic as well, because in addition to my own experiences, I spoke to other people and they talked about how they coped. And so, you know, that's, I used to, a little side issue, I used to, my husband and I would go out a lot. We would go to movies and out for meals and things. And I would often see groups of single women together. And I would always think, one day that's going to be me going out with just the girls. Mm-hmm. Sure enough, I'm in that sorority now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's quite a change. And I attended some workshops in preparing for the book, and one of the issues that came up discussed by a major grief counselor was that when a woman loses her husband, she often loses all her social contacts.
Yeah.
And she's not invited places because she's a single woman. And in some cases, single women are looked at as threats, and as nonsensical as that seems. But
especially by older women, because, you know, they're older and they're afraid of younger women. And
yeah.
A new single woman, you know, in the mix.
Well, I remember one of my friends, her husband didn't die, but they got divorced. And she lost a lot of friends. And one of the excuses that she told me that was given to her is, I'd like to invite you, but I like an even number at the table.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Can you imagine how shallow a person that is? Oh, my God.
I have a friend whose husband passed away now 2 years ago. And she has cut herself off from everybody and told me, I can't do anything that we did together. I don't want to do anything without him. And that breaks my heart, because she's isolated herself now.
Yeah. I mean, and she's not doing herself any good. I think sometimes those group therapy groups, you know, bereavement groups are really helpful. Then, and your life has changed. I mean, so, and you have to get on with it. And I'm sort of a pragmatic person, not sort of, I am. So then you start nobody invites me. I had one widow friend, the phone never rings. And I said, well, do you ever call? I mean, you have to extend yourself. And because you can't live in isolation, and especially after losing your companion, the lifelong companion, it's never going to be the same. So now you have to build something different that will work for you, that's realistic.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask you something, because I know we're running out of time here. Do you think that, you know, in third world countries where death rates are much higher, they seem more able to cope? I'm not saying it doesn't hurt as much. Obviously, the death of a loved one hurts, and I don't care who you are. But
absolutely,
because they have higher mortality rates, they seem to be able to get on with the process faster, because I think in America, the United States, with medical doctors and people living longer and longer and that kind of thing, we almost are kind of fooling ourselves into thinking we're immortals. Do you think that maybe third world countries are a little luckier because they haven't gotten to that point?
I don't know if it's just different. I don't know if it's lucky, but it's different. And in so many of those countries, it's more community-oriented. So the community steps in. The community pays for the funeral in some places. The community has their tasks prescribed. And everybody, because it's so commonplace, everybody knows what they, you know, what their task is. And I think that really does help if you know. And that's why I feel it's so important in this country, because we're so, you know, emphasis is on the individual rather than the community and the family. It's so important to talk about death ahead of time, when you have, you know, what's going to happen, what will I do if, have advanced directives. There's something called 5 wishes that you can get online. I think it costs a nickel or something. And it tells, you know, what if your pain is blah, blah, blah? What do you want to have done? I think it's the individual's responsibility to those that the individual loves, to their loved ones, to make known what their wishes are and not just have the family guess. And I had a friend, and he was a physician, and he said, the one thing I absolutely don't want is if I become ill and they want to put me on dialysis, I don't want dialysis. Well, because he was a physician and it was such a beloved doctor, when it came time, they put him on dialysis. He came to, and he pulled out the plugs himself. I mean, you know. Mm-hmm. We need to let others know what it is that we want, and it's our responsibility to let others know just exactly our desires for end of life. I know during this, you're talking about politics, because right now the debates are over. I've got them on mute, but I know falsely and erroneously, this is a political statement, they were saying that if Obama were elected again, he would have death panels. Well, that was such a misstatement. Mm-hmm. It's about talking about what you want for yourself with, and making your wishes known with your physician and those that you love. And it's the only responsible thing that we can do as individuals to spare our families any extra pain. And we have to have it in writing. So I would recommend anybody listening to me go online. That's an assumption that everybody has a computer, but go online and look up 5 wishes. And it's not legal in every state. It's legal in California, and now I'm living in New Mexico, and it's legal here. And it's like a living will, and I really recommend it to everybody. And also to buy my book.
Yes.
Saying goodbye to someone you love, published by Demos Health, D-E-M-O-S.
Yeah, this book has everything in it. Nuts and Bolts is one of the topics of one of the discussions. I mean, I love the way you title the different things, the elephant in the room. I love
yes.
that. You describe the discussion. Okay, so Mo is going to die, but there's an elephant in the room because nobody wants to say that. Nobody wants to say, okay, Mo is sick all the time. There's a really good chance she's not going to wake up. What do we do when that happens? And
well, what you don't want to say to Mo is, you look really good today. We've got to be honest.
Yeah. I have a funny story. We're going to Ireland. And this time I said, in an urn, but I'm going to Ireland this time, you know, go home. And so I went into a store to get some things, and the woman was helping me. And I walked with a cane, and she was kind of pulling on me. And she says, okay, she says, I'm going to try not to pull you over. I says, I'm not frail. I'm just half dead. And she kind of looked at me like, ooh. Yes. And then she smiled. I said, it's okay. You know, I'm not frail. Because earlier in the week, she was helping an older lady, and she was trying to adjust something, and she pulled the woman over. And oh. She looked at me, and she's like, I'm trying not to pull your eyes. She says, I'm not frail. I'm just half dead. But a lot of people can't do that.
I know.
Family members can't look at it and say, look, every morning I wake up, I'm the most surprised person in the room.
Right.
Wow. Am I still
That's
here?
That's right.
How did I pull this off? You know?
Yeah.
But there are stages. Another part of the book that I find which is really helpful, and the elephant in the room, of course, is the discussion between
right.
either families or even the person who's ill. You know it's coming. And there are people who will say, don't talk about death. Don't talk about death. It'll happen. Well, hell yeah, it's going to happen. You know,
that's right.
Later, it's going to happen either out in the street in a car or God almighty, you know, Shadow Seer is in the chat. And he works in a printing shop in North Jersey, which is right next to a funeral parlor. And they'll have a shooting in the town, and 3 days later, he watches everybody come for the funeral, and they're the same people that shot them. You know,
yeah.
Yeah, you're gonna die. That's what's
yeah.
gonna happen. You know, so that's the elephant in the room, and families just kind of, well, if we don't talk about it, it won't happen.
And also, if we talk about it, we'll make the person more upset, and that will hasten the death. And meanwhile, the person is lying there saying, well, if I bring up the subject of dying, well, then I'll upset my family. So in many ways, everybody's trying to protect the other person, but you can't do that. It never works.
Yeah. The other part in here is there are stages to grief.
Yes.
And could we just talk for a minute or two about the stages, because everybody goes through them at their own pace. Some people, it takes years to work through it. Other people, maybe months, you know. It kind of, but there are stages to grief, right?
Yes.
And they...
And the denial and the anger, and then I forget the other stages. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross put together a scale, and you're right, we go through it at different times.
The first is shock, like in denial.
Well, you know, the funny thing about shock, my husband was in hospice for a year, and when the hospice nurse was there to check him, and I said something, and she says, well, you know he's dying. And I knew she meant right at this moment, and it was a shock. It was a shock. He's in the other room, and he's breathing. He's talking. She said, "No, he's dying." Mm-hmm. And when my father was dying in the hospital, my brother called up and said, "Dad is dead." And my stomach flip flopped. Well, I knew he was dying, but still, the finality of it is always a shock.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is. My mother was 84. She had a very bad heart. And still, when I got there, it was like, oh, shite. You know, she's dead. You know, man. You know? Then people go through the pain and guilt. I went through pain. It was heartbreaking for me. My mother and my aunt and I were like the three musketeers. We were always together. A lot of people go through the guilt thing. You know, I should have, what if. And one of the things my friend is going through is she turned off life support. Even though it was a hopeless situation, she says, I killed him. I killed him. He didn't die till I turned off life support. I says, no.
Oh, yeah, that's tough, yeah.
And I says, but he would have died within a week. You just, you know, made it worse by holding on. You let him go, and that was the gentler thing to do. Another part of it is anger and bargaining. Then you get this anger like, well, how dare they die? You know, like they had a choice, you know? And then depression and loneliness, and that's then the upward turn kind of thing is rebuilding your life without that person.
Right.
These are all.
That's when you adopt Tommy from the pound and put all your extra dollars to the vet.
That's when you tell your daughter, "No, I don't want to hear. Do not want to hear about this." I know. We only had an hour to talk about this, and it is a great book. The book is Saying Goodbye to Someone You Love, Your Emotional Journey Through the End of Life and Grief. And, Norine, you wrote this because even though you knew your husband was going to die, you kind of, after it all happened, got caught with your britches down, kind of, you know?
Yeah.
You had to deal with the whole emotion thing. You have great anecdotes in here. And there, if you go on YouTube and type in Norine Dresser, N-O-R-I-N-E Dresser, D-R-E-S-S-E-R, there's a YouTube of her husband's party that she talked about when she first came on with the belly dancer. And that's kind of the whole way through the book. It's got great, great advice. It's got great things in there to talk about, ways of dealing, and a lot of people's stories on how to deal with things so that you realize you're not feeling something strange. It's a great book.
Oh, thank you very much. I think I mentioned to you that the Library Journal named it as one of the best self-help books for 2010, which was the year it came out.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a big coup for us. And I wanted to mention that my co-author is Freda Wasserman,
mm-hmm.
who has all kinds of fabulous credentials in grief counseling and marriage and family counseling, and is a key person at an organization called Our House, which specializes in grief counseling in Los Angeles, Southern California.
Yeah, I'm typing it in for the people in the chat. It's called Our House Grief Support Center.
It's just Our House, isn't that funny? Let's see, Our House. Maybe it's on the cover here in front
of me. It is. It's on the cover. It says Our House Grief Support Center.
Yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And the book, again, Saying Goodbye, it talks about everything you need to know to deal with. And even if you've lost someone already, it's got things in your stories, self-help stuff. Ideas. See, in our family, we don't have a big problem. If Teddy dies, I already told him I'm sticking a bone up his arse and letting the dogs have at him. I'm not worrying about it. The family knows no wake, no kind of viewing, no funeral thing. Just let them cremate us and then tell them to dump us in the ocean or something, you know, like that, you know. But have a big party after it, because
right.
I know I'm going to be dancing. I know I'm going to be having a party, and that's what I want my children to remember me for. So,
right.
Thank you so much for coming on, and perhaps you'll come on again sometime, and we'll talk about different cultural you know, ways of burying people and stuff like that. But
I'd be happy to.
Yeah, I want to thank you so much for coming on, and all you have to do is hang up.
Okay, thanks so much, Mo.
Good night. That was very interesting. During the break, this time we're going to have Wolf of Man by Metallica, and we're going to be bringing on our next guest onto the telephone during the break, Chad Hopkins, and we're going to be talking about Lyndhurst Estate in New York and its shadowed past. They're having awesome Halloween stuff going on there. This weekend is something great going on. And we'll be right back. This is Mo Banshee's Lair, and we're going to be talking about Shadow Pass of Lyndhurst next.
You are listening to Game Con Radio.
Got questions.
Who are we?
Where do we come from?
Are we alone in the universe?
Is there life after death?
Where can I take a class and really learn about demonology?
Now, get the answers. For a decade, the American Institute of Metaphysics has offered the ultimate in courses designed to serve as the foundation in your search for life's questions. The courses cover a variety of subject areas and consist of wide-ranging alternative sciences, theories, and philosophies. Each course comes complete with textbooks, work materials, and instructions. The courses allow you the freedom to pursue your own areas of interest according to your schedule. Whether it's UFOs, life after death, demonology, cryptozoology, and more, you've got questions, we've got answers. Visit www.instituteofmetaphysics.com or call 877-623-3241 and start your search now.
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. And tonight we have a doubleheader, and our next guest is Chad Thompson, right? Tompkins. And he's associated with Lyndhurst Estate in Tarry Town, New York. And I went to Lyndhurst for the Dark Shadows Convention back in August. And this is an incredible estate that is a Gothic castle. It's really a Gothic castle in the middle of Tarry Town. Welcome to the Lair, Chad.
Thank you so much for having me, Mo.
Tell us about Lyndhurst Estate.
Well, first of all, I want to say hi to all the crew at Lyndhurst. And I know they're recording this and listening to it. They couldn't stay up too late. They have to work tomorrow. But Christine, Kristen, David, Rena, and Lisa are all the full-time employees there now. Lyndhurst has gone through quite a change over the last couple of years, and in the historic preservation world, they were one of the lowest-grossing tourist attractions. In other words, they were not making money at all for their nonprofit, but they weren't making any money to keep the doors open. So it was kind of sad. I had been working with the former director and so forth to try to do some functions, and got to know them very well, and of course had been going there for quite a few years to visit for various functions, and all of a sudden they let go seven directors and full-time staff people, and I had to get to know everybody all over again. So the five people I just mentioned are there at Lyndhurst now, pretty much taking care of everything. They wear a lot of hats, each particular mm-hmm. member. They're all wonderful people, and took me under their wing, and know that I'm a big fan and supporter of their property, and for various reasons. I do like, historical things, and of course, from Dark Shadows fandom over the years, and they're very big involved in that, and which we'll get into in a little bit, but but anyway, they were doing pretty bad there for a while. So now this new group of people has really have done some really interesting things, including this whole month long celebration, which started about 2 weeks ago and goes up until the end of the month for a Halloween function and a tour of the house, which is all decorated now and has some really cool, interesting things in there, which I'll also go into momentarily. But Lyndhurst is just a great, great historical, you know, if you didn't like it for any other reason but historical value, it's got tons and tons of historical value, and especially with Jay Gould, one of the former owners who was railroad tycoon, and he was also very big Wall Street, made a lot of money on Wall Street and had a lot of money to invest in the house and the grounds and so forth. So from that standpoint, the house is just interesting historically. How I got into it is, of course, through Dark Shadows fandom, and which, of course, the original Dark Shadows ran on ABC TV from 1966 to 1971. And, you know, of course, when I was a little kid, watched it when my brother and sister were older, and we all kind of watched it as a family over the years, which is, it's kind of a special show to me for that reason. It's like the only show my whole family ever really gathered around, believe it or not. So it's very special that way. And over the years, I had been a fan of Dark Shadows and got involved in the festivals and, you know, met many of the stars, celebrities over the years. And, you know, in more recent years, got very, very interested in the filming locations of Dark Shadows. And then I found out that Lyndhurst was home of the two motion pictures. House of Dark Shadows was the first motion picture that was filmed there. Not the entire movie, but I would say roughly about a half of the movie was filmed there, and then other various locations in Connecticut and so forth, and the surrounding areas up in Tarrytown. And, of course, the follow-up movie, right as Dark Shadows went off in 1971, they released A Night of Dark Shadows. And that whole movie was entirely shot on the estate in Tarrytown, New York. And it's just so amazing that you can actually still go there and see, you know, where these movies were filmed and pretty much see all the locations. There's only a few areas you really can't go on the estate, but for the most part, you can pretty much see where everything was filmed, and that's just a neat aspect of not only being a Dark Shadows fan, but also being a Lyndhurst fan.
Mm-hmm. It is a gorgeous estate. It was, the house itself was designed in 1838 by Alexander Jackson Davis, and it was also, at one time, a New York mayor's home, and then eventually it fell into the hands of railroad tycoon Jay Gould, and it's his daughter who donated it to the National Trust. But the whole property is like a huge park.
Yes, it's almost like theme park in a way. I mean,
yeah.
William Paulding was the first owner, and George Merritt was the second, and then, you know, of course, the latter of the Goulds. And just, you know, for reference there for those historians listening.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I just find it amazing because you can pretty much go any day of the week, and we might want to just mention that it's at 635 South Broadway in Tarrytown is the location. For those that are not familiar with it. And, you know, pretty much from 8 to 4 daily, the grounds are open. You can actually go and tour the grounds, and it doesn't cost anything to tour the grounds most of the year. And when they're having special functions, of course, then there's, you know, or you have to check the website to see availability. But for the most part, it's actually a part of a historical walk now. You can actually walk part of it as... and continue on. They're actually trying to connect different historical places. And, of course, being up there as well as Sleepy Hollow and Washington Irving and the Headless Horseman, and you had mentioned earlier this evening, was one of your favorite Halloween characters. And, of course, Tarry Town, New York is actually known, you know, for that. But it's really just interesting, that whole surrounding area up there. There's so much to do. And when we were up there a couple weeks ago at the opening of this October celebration at Lyndhurst, we met so many people that were, you know, just there for the weekends, and they were going to all these really cool things, you know, the Dutch church and seeing the reenactment of the Headless Horseman, and of course the Sleepy Hollow Cemetery is there, and Washington Irving is buried there. And you can actually, near the church, the, I don't know, a lot of people may not know this, but some of the actual graves had names of real people that actually appear in the story. They're actually real people, so it's kind of cool. And of course, Dark Shadows, House of Dark Shadows, actually filmed at the cemetery. The mausoleum is at the cemetery as well. So it's just another, for those Dark Shadows fans listening, and I know there's, they found out I was going to be on, quite a few are listening tonight, and it's just a really neat, and you can actually do a tour of the Sleepy Hollow Cemetery at night by lantern, which we've done before, and that's very, very neat as well. But the grounds up there, it's incredible. You have not only on the estate, you have the greenhouse, which is just so, it doesn't have the glass in it anymore, but it's so big and incredible looking, and of course that was used in the Night of Dark Shadows movie. The pool house, which is actually closed now, they're hoping to renovate that at some point, was used in both movies. The guest house is there. It's actually offices, you know, for the Lyndhurst staff members, and pretty much closed off. They have the stable area, which you can go to. They hold weddings there. It's also called the carriage house, and of course, those were used in the films. And believe it or not, actually, the original Dark Shadows series was one of the first shows to actually use live shots. So they would actually take the actors out like a week or two before the actually filming of the show, and they would take them to different places. Like the main house that was used in the show was actually Seaview Terrace up in Newport, Rhode Island, and on the opening scenes. And they would actually take the actors there, or to Essex, Connecticut was another big filming area, and also Lyndhurst for several scenes. And it would show the actor walking across the grounds or up to a door and going into the doorway, and then it would cut back to the actual studio shot at ABC, and they would go inside. It was kind of groundbreaking for that, that 60s, you know, so that's really cool. But there's a lot of that film there. And they actually have the bowling alley, which can be seen in Night of Dark Shadows, but they've actually put a lot of renovation into that, and it's got open restrooms for the public now that are doing the historical walks through there. And and again, some of the historians listening may not remember, but I know Dark Shadows fans will remember the Spratt Mansion, which was actually kind of off the Lyndhurst property to the left as you're going down the hill towards the Hudson River, and near the railroad bridge. On the left-hand side, it was back in there. There was an old house, and I believe at that time you could access it through Lyndhurst, and that was used as the old house in the original Dark Shadows series, and it burned down in 1970. And, of course, a lot of fans, every time they go up there, they try to go through the woods and find where it was and get a brick from it. But I know a lot of people didn't actually know where it was, but it was actually right adjacent to Lyndhurst.
Lyndhurst, when we went there, the tours that go through, they show you where the different scenes and movies were shot there. But this place actually has I don't know what you call them, turrets, you know. This house, when you look at it, it looks like something that King Arthur might live in, or, you know, some king. and it's perfect for dark shadows. There are sections of the house, when they go on tour there, they're not allowed to take flash pictures, right?
Correct. And actually, at one time, you weren't allowed to take pictures at all, but the new regime there is actually very generous now. They allow you to take it, and most of the time, it's simply because of, like, the paintings and mm-hmm. stuff. They have the original paintings in the art gallery, absolutely exquisite, and, you know, the flash photography does hurt them, so... If you go there and you do want to take pictures, you know, like with your cell phone, you know, just turn off the flash, and they're more than accommodating to let you do that, and which is just amazing because a lot of people over the years have just wanted pictures of their favorite scene and, you know, maybe the Dark Shadows movies or something like that. So, you know, now you can actually get that. So it's pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
But they decorated the house incredibly. During the day... I will tell you that they're doing the historical tour is still you know going on Thursday through Sunday. It starts at 10 in the morning. It's about a 50-minute tour, so say about an hour after all said and done, and it runs $18. And you know they'll take you for the most part through the whole entire house. The tower rooms are actually still closed off. Which I know a lot of Dark Shadows fans are upset they can't always go up there, but you know some of the construction needs to be done, and of course that's why we're pushing this because obviously Lyndhurst needs the money, and
mm-hmm.
We want to keep it open for not only Dark Shadows fans, but obviously for historical reference, you know. So, but anyway, there are some of those places you still can't go even during the daytime, but then. After dark, which is Lyndhurst's new program, and you can see some of the props during the day trip, but I'll tell you what, when you pull up and it starts getting dark out at like 5, 6 o'clock now, and you walk down to the house in the dark and it's all lit up and, you know, it's just absolutely gorgeous and spooky all at the same time. And, you know, they're just so much internally. They have a music provided, someone's playing the piano and the organ, kind of a, you know, gothic music and you know, mm-hmm. scary music and pieces, and it's piped out through the house. In the entryway, you know, you'll get one of the tour guides to show you part of it, and then you can kind of go through on your own and see some of the rooms that they've decorated, and the library has like a tarot card, kind of a gypsy, you know, future seer type of setting in there, which is really neat. And then the main room to the left as you go in, which would be like your parlor or your entertainment room, actually has someone has donated a coffin. And they have that all lit up, and of course they have Barnabas's cape hanging over, and Bob Issel from Illinois has sent Lyndhurst a reproduction of the original Barnabas portrait from House of Dark Shadows, and they've blown it up and they have it in there hanging, so it's
oh, very wow.
And another tribute to to Dark Shadows, but it was really awesome to see that. And then Jay Gould's office, which is across the way, they've got like the Grim Reaper in there, and because of Jay Gould, they believed he trafficked with the devil, and because he was so successful on Wall Street and so forth. And then you can go down to the end of the hall and see the dining room, and has kind of a gothic setup. And they're using a lot of original plates and silverware and things like that that you don't normally get to see. So again, it's really neat. They've shut off the downstairs, so the night tours are a little bit smaller, but there's so much to see, it's still really interesting. But so they couldn't do every room, obviously, to try to be cost effective. But then you go up to the second floor, and they've got some of the bedrooms redone. They have one of the bathrooms that's redone in the Psycho tribute to Psycho movie. They have the which sounds like the shower's running with the shower curtain, and there's bloody handprints all over it, and the knife is in there with the blood on the floor and handprints and blood on the window and that's very interesting. There's a Night of Dark Shadows poster in the hall. And then, of course, when you go down to the library, they have Laura Parker, who played Angelique in Night of Dark Shadows. Of course, she was on the original series, too, has loaned them a copy of her portrait from Night of Dark Shadows, and that's on display in the library as well. And they have two other rooms in there. They have a werewolf room, and they talk about the actual werewolf disease, which actually was a common thing back in the day. People had hair growing out of their bodies and not so normal parts, and they felt like it was a werewolf disease. And there's another room where there's a body laying out, and of course, back in the day, they didn't have these funeral homes, and they would lay the bodies out in the parlor, and you know, people would come to see their loved ones from miles away, and you know, basically 24 hours a day, they were allowed to come and see, you know, the passing of their loved one, and somebody would be on guard with the body. And that's kind of where they got the terminology of a wake. Kind of came from that. And so they kind of give you all that. And then, of course, I'm really excited because I have me and several of my friends made a life-size Barnabas figure several years ago. And from the House of Dark Shadows, when Jonathan Pritt played Barnabas Collins, he turned into an actual 200-year-old man. And, you know, very old and weathered, but still had the fangs and the fingernails and all that. And there's a life-size mannequin in there, and that belongs to me. And it's on donation to Lyndhurst for the month of October for these After Dark tours. And everybody's telling me how it's scaring the crap out of them, so they're really enjoying that. They wanted to also do the hanging of Angelique in the back tree, which was, you know, the actual tree that they filmed the scenes from in Night of Dark Shadows, but the leaves were not the trees yet, so they moved the body in the house, and actually from the minstrel loft, where they used to have the minstrels play music while people were in the library sitting area, they've actually hung Angelique, or a replica of Angelique hanging.
In effigy.
It's awesome. I mean, and it's all, you know, at night, so it's just very spooky and very cool. And I've had a lot of people in my committee that's been helping out do tours on the weekends. And we talked a little bit earlier that Sharon Smyth, who played
Sarah
Collins on the original Dark Shadows, will be there this coming week, the 20th, right?
October 20th, yeah.
And she'll be signing autographs and meeting everybody, and she's really excited about doing that. And then the last weekend of the month, the 27th, we have Jim Fife from the 1991 Dark Shadows, played Willie Loomis, will be there from 1 to 4 signing autographs. And
wow.
For donations. And it's all going to a great cause. We want to keep this property open, and we really, really want to have Lyndhurst keep rolling for many, many moons to come. So,
one of my favorite Halloween children's specials is the Halloween That Almost Wasn't with Judd Hurst.
Okay.
And that was filmed there, too, some scenes from it.
Yeah, and I'm actually amazed. I'm 'cause every week I'm calling, you know, we're very... very close to a bunch of folks, and they consider us family. It's so neat that we're, you know, we're helping out them, and, you know, of course, it's all a labor of love. I mean, they obviously work there full time, but, you know, we just love the property and love that run it. So I'm in constant contact with them about, you know, bettering things. And of course, this is going to be hopefully an ongoing thing every year. And we've already been talking about what we're going to do to make it better next year. So with adding maybe some live performers to play some of the characters and things like that. But it's still pretty spectacular, and they've just done a real great job in a short amount of time. But I've also talked to one of the ladies up there that books the property, and they've actually, I believe, Warner Brothers is coming in to film another movie there shortly, right around Halloween. And they just filmed, Hallmark finished another movie there. So this is, again, great news for Lyndhurst.
You know, right.
That movie companies are actually using that beautiful property to do some filming, and it's just really, it's a great place. And I could just drive around there for hours.
Well, we're going to go to break, and then we're going to talk about the tours that are going through and give them times and numbers that they can get a hold of. And the site is lyndhurst.org, and it's / upcomings / events / Halloween / but we're going to go to break, and the last song that we have tonight is Love Potion by the Clovers, and we'll be right back. We're talking about Lyndhurst Estate. It's in Tarrytown, New York, and Tarrytown is just like a mile from Sleepy Hollow Cemetery. And one thing that I noticed, the town planners have planned it very well, because there are companies there, I believe craft and all, but when you're driving in, you don't see anything. Everything is laid out so beautifully in Tarrytown that they haven't destroyed the beautiful natural look of the area. It still looks like something you read Washington Irving, and you can imagine it's still looking that way. We'll be right back. This is Game Con Radio, rocking your night.
You are listening to Game Con Radio.
Yes? Hi, I'm here for the New York Ghost Tour.
Sorry, we're closed. But you can come back next week.
Next week? Forget that. I'll just go check out another place.
Trust me, there's no place half as interesting as ours, dear.
That's so not true. What about the Shanley Hotel in Napanock?
Once you've been to one haunted hotel, you've been to them all.
Not like this place. The Shanley Hotel dates back to 1845, and since then it's been a hotspot for paranormal activity. Mysterious music, smells, whistling, doors opening, footsteps, almost everything you can imagine has been experienced at that hotel.
It's open to the public?
Absolutely. Sal and Cindy, the owners of the hotel, welcome people for regular stays or investigations, and their rates are beyond reasonable. They even offer workshops and in-house psychics.
How did you learn about this place?
By visiting www.shanleyhotel.com. You can get history, investigation info, and much more.
Thanks, I think I will. Just don't tell any of our customers.
Your secret's safe with me. It's not like anyone can...
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We're rocking your world. We do have an announcement to make. As of next week, we're going to be changing up our time slot, and the show will be starting, I believe, 9 and ending at 11. We're going to be an hour earlier, and before that, Negative Trait is going to be coming on. I don't know what the show is going to be called, but he's going to be playing classic rock, Metallica, you name it. He's going to be rocking the airwaves, and I think everybody's really going to enjoy it. So there's going to be a new DJ on before me, and I'm going to up my show an hour on Tuesdays, which I'm sure my listeners in England are going to be over the moon about, because my show starts at 3 a.m. over there, and praise God, we have had a very strong European contingent. I can't tell you how amazed I am when people from all over the world tell me, we listen to your show. It's just very awesome. And God bless all the people who listen to this show and are interested in interesting things that interest me. So if you have an idea for a for a guest and you have something that interests you, by all means, contact me at asylumsgate.com. That's my site. You can always find me there. There's a free, registration. It is one of the first sites that was dedicated to anomalous, unexplained phenomena. And so I'm very proud of the site. It's one of the first ones. It was long before the Ghostbusters and all that. So we've been in the thick of unexplained phenomena for years. And I think it's wonderful that, we're still going. Our guest tonight, Chad, is a friend of the Lyndhurst Estate in Tarrytown. And they're having incredible stuff for Halloween. I became involved with the Lyndhurst and trying to get the word out about it because I went to a Dark Shadows convention there, and I had no clue there were Dark Shadows conventions. Catherine Lee Scott was the one who said, yeah, we have conventions all the time. And so I went to one, and it was at Lyndhurst. And it's wonderful because two of the movies were shot there. And it's so close to the cemetery, the Sleepy Hollow Cemetery, where some scenes from the movies were shot, where Barnabas's crypt is and where Willie Loomis is walking around drunk and breaking bottles and stuff, looking for Barnabas's grave and all. So when you go to the area, there is so much to look at. There's, I think, the Roosevelt estate is there also, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. And on Saturday, let's start with Saturday because that's the next weekend coming up. Sharon is going to be leading. There's going to be tours during the day. Some are pay for, some are free. Is that the way I'm understanding it?
Yes. Well, again, being part of the National Historic Preservation, they do allow foot traffic on the property. Pretty much Monday through every day, pretty much from like 10 to 4. You can just go on and you can see all the neat things that we were talking about earlier, the greenhouse and the pool house and the stable area. And sometimes they do have the tent up down at the stables, so you can't always go into the area and so forth. They do, they cater weddings and they are having other filming projects on the estate. Mm-hmm. But now, if you're close enough by there, you can go up, I would recommend going up as many times, during the year as you can. If I lived closer, I'd probably be there once a month. But
yeah.
It's just so beautiful. And I mean, but they don't always have the tent up, and you can actually go and see some of the stable areas and, again, some of the filming locations for the house. And this whole month has been incredible. I was up there the first weekend. A couple of my committee members were with me and helped out doing the tours. And of course they're not all familiar with the Dark Shadows as we are, but we're working hand in hand with them. And with the release of Johnny Depp's new Dark Shadows movie this past May, and it's out on DVD now, people can get familiar with Dark Shadows again. And that was a little bit different twist than the original show or the 91 series, which was with Ben Cross on NBC, which was short-lived, one season. And WB actually did a pilot back in 2004 when Dan Curtis was still alive, and we should say that Dan Curtis was the brainchild for Dark Shadows. He brought Dark Shadows to life, and the whole original series, 91, and they actually put a couple million dollars, WB Network, into a pilot. And those of us who went to the festivals, as you just mentioned, we were able to see the pilot several times. It's not available on DVD or anything, but one of the Dan Curtis production members brought it and showed it to us, and it was really interesting. It was going to be, a little more different and more modern, and this really neat, and unfortunately, WB Network kind of screwed up and chose not to go forward with it, so it didn't happen. But Dark Shadows, after all these years, since 1966 on to here we are going on 50 years, is still very strong, has a very strong following, and of course, those of us who love Dark Shadows love the filming locations, and Lyndhurst Estate being one of them. But this particular weekend, Sharon Smyth Lentz, who played Sarah Collins in the original Dark Shadows series, will be available on Saturday. She's going to be. They have a tent set up at the entrance to Lyndhurst, where they actually have the gift shop, and they have Dark Shadows items for sale. They have regular Lyndhurst items, T-shirts, and all kinds of neat things up there for sale. Halloween candy, spooky Halloween stuff, and that you can purchase. And she'll be up there signing autographs, and I believe she's going to be in the house later on in the evening as well. And she will pretty much sign anything you bring, and I believe you just have to make a donation. I'm pretty sure she'll have some 8x10s for sale if you don't have anything that you can think of you want to bring to have signed. She'll have pictures there to sign, and it will be a small fee. But donations would also be accepted for Lyndhurst. And again, that's 635 South Broadway in Tarry Town, New York. The website is www.lyndhurst.org. We'll take you to the main page, and then you can see the historical tours with a twist. You can actually buy tickets online, Mo. That's something new that they're doing.
Uh-huh.
The day tours start at 10 a.m. and they go to 4 p.m. It's $18, and you can purchase your ticket right online. The After Dark special is the 5 o'clock showing, and where the house is all lit up. It does have a lot of Dark Shadows flavor to it. And they're going till around 9 o'clock. They said even some nights they might go later, depending on the response. But I know tickets have been selling out pretty quickly, so to make sure you can get them, I would definitely go online and not take your chances just driving up there unless you live awful close. And then the following weekend, the 27th, we have Jim Fife from the 1991 Dark Shadows series, played Willie Loomis, who hasn't made a Dark Shadows appearance, I should say, since 93. So this is I'm very honored that he has agreed to do this, and I'll be going up there myself, so you can say hi to me. I'll be in the tent area somewhere, I'm sure, with Jim, and he'll be signing. And the After Dark tickets, I should say, are a little bit more, $25. But, of course, all this is going towards a great estate and just, you know, just to preserve our history, really. I mean, you know, Dark Shadows is a great part of our history, too, but the actual historical relevance is even more important to keep that, and we just want to keep that rolling. And it seems like they're on a roll now. They've had a lot of weddings and fundraisers and things like that, and I just say the more we can go to support them, the better. And they'll be doing a scarecrow fest sometime this month up there, too, where all the scarecrows will be on the lawn. You can check that out on their website, too. They have all the kids from the surrounding schools come in and decorate scarecrows. It's just very cool. And, you know, they know they're going to have a Christmas thing, too, this year. They usually do every year, but I believe, not quite sure on all the details of that yet, but somebody said something about possible a live Christmas carol performance there at the house, which would be awesome as well. And I did want to interject one thing. You were talking about the surrounding areas there. You were mentioning mm-hmm. Sleepy Hollow Cemetery. And there, a little bit further down in Scarborough, which is right off that same route, Route 9, if people haven't been up there before, Lyndhurst looks right out on the Hudson River. And you can see the Tappan Zee Bridge. It's absolutely gorgeous.
I was going to mention that.
I'm sorry.
It's a beautiful landscape.
Yeah, it really is. And I mean, you know, different times of the year, it's so amazing. I know the winter time's a little tough to take pictures of, but the fall and the spring and the summer are just great. I mean, mm-hmm. you got at least three seasons, you can really take some great pictures up there and without, you know, freezing or anything. And then, but further down Route 9 up there, which is the main route that goes past the cemetery, it goes into Scarborough. And off the Scarborough Road, there is a couple more Dark Shadows locations that they filmed up there. The actual Scarborough train station, which is now the post office up there, was the original, the first original Dark Shadows episode, with the train station where Victoria Winters gets off the train in Collinsport for the first show of Dark Shadows.
Okay.
And that's up there. And there's the Shoals Estate, which is not really tourable because it's privately owned, but you can drive by and snap a few pictures here and there. But I did want to mention a dear friend of mine and a fellow Dark Shadows person, Shelley Weiss-Losty, has written a book, and maybe at some point you can have her on, but she asked if I would just let people know. She's done a book called Dark Shadows, A View of Collinsport, and she put this out several years ago, around 2006, and it's an awesome, awesome book. It actually has an extensive section on Lyndhurst and Tarrytown. So if you can get a copy of this book, when I first got this, I carried it everywhere with me because I wanted to see where Dark Shadows mm-hmm. was shot. And she has gone into such detail, which, you know, she can explain to you and so forth. But if anyone would like the book, she doesn't have a website, but I do have the address here if that's okay to give.
Sure.
It's P.O. Box 225, 3000 Whitney Avenue, and that's in Hamden, Connecticut, and it's 06518. Again, the book is called Dark Shadows, A View of Collinsport, and it's $20 plus $5 for shipping, and she'd be happy to sign it for you as well. But, I mean, just for me to learn where all things were, and I was very also privileged this summer, because you were at the same fest I was, I met another great Dark Shadows fan, but also a film historian, Darren Gross, who was actually discovered the edited version of Night of Dark Shadows, and had been piecemealing it back together with the original audio and all the deleted scenes. And later on this month, the two movies, House of Dark Shadows and Night of Dark Shadows, will actually be out on DVD and Blu-ray for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
They've only been available on video before, so people who want to really get to know the house and so forth can actually buy those movies. Unfortunately, they had decided not to put the deleted scenes that were restored in yet. So we're going to have to wait, but Darren lives in L.A. He's probably listening, and dear friend, and he did a wonderful job. I've seen several of the scenes that he reconstructed, and this was the way Dan Curtis wanted it to be shown, and unfortunately, the movie was chopped up a lot, even though it's still a good movie. It's even better with all those deleted scenes, so I just wanted to plug that, because Darren was here this summer, and we got to go on a private tour of Lyndhurst, and he was showing us where scenes with Kate Jackson were filmed, and he just knows the movie and different spots that, you know, we had no idea. We were just sitting there with our mouths open, just in awe of all the stuff that he knew.
Yeah, Christine and I went back on Sunday after the luncheon, or before the luncheon, and we found the train trestle where they had the fight, you know, the two guys were duking it out on the train trestle typey thing, and one of the guys got knocked out or something, it's incredible. And then you go to the stables, and the up in the top of the stables is where the vampire Carolyn gets staked, you know. And it's got some great movie stuff going for it, but in its own right, it is just like I said, it's a Gothic castle in the middle of New York. It is absolutely gorgeous. You know, the house speaks multitudes just on its own. And I'm really, my daughter and I are just so excited that we're going up there to see it decorated for Halloween, you know. And it's easy to access, too. It's right off the Tappan Zee Bridge. It's not hard to get to by any means.
Right. And most of the stuff is actually accessible. I mean, they have, not only Lyndhurst has their website, but they have Facebook page. And, you know, I'm available for any of your listeners that want to Facebook me. I'm under Chad Conley Hopkins on Facebook, and they could, you know, ask me questions. We also have a, we're working on a reunion for the 91 series. We have that going on, and that's our Facebook page as well, Friends of the 91 Dark Shadows. And you can ask questions. We'll be glad to answer that. And it's just such a really neat, thing, just you know, just not be only where they shot these movies, because most places, you know, when you go to filming locations, you know, the things aren't there anymore, and you know, and it's hard to. But this is really not only that, but you're getting the historical aspect of it, but you're getting your favorite TV show or movies, as the case may be, and it's just really interesting to see. So, any of your listeners can contact me, or just get on the Facebook pages and talk it up, because, you know, we do so many things up there, and it's just such a great place to go. And, you know, there's other filming locations, and Shelley's book mentions all that. So if you're a real big Dark Shadows fan and you go, hey, I would love to, you know, go to Essex, Connecticut, or Norwalk, or Newport, she even goes into the California where they filmed the 91 series and things like that. She goes into all that. It's very detailed. So if you need any more information, they can contact me.
Mm-hmm. And, I have it, Chad.Hopkins on Facebook.
Chad Conley Hopkins on Facebook, right.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I'll be there on the 27th with Jim Fife, and of course Sharon will be there this weekend. And
I'll be there this weekend.
Well, good, and make sure you tell Sharon I can.
Oh, by the way, yeah, it's a wonderful place, and it's a good way to get your Halloween going. One of the most famous franchises. This predates Dark Shadow, predates all your Twilight, all of that stuff. The first vampire with a soul was Barnabas Collins, and so that is there. And then it's an absolute time capsule. It reflects what we used to call the Gilded Age. That's when millionaires had money, and they wanted to live like the aristocracy in Europe. And so what they did was, in America, they built castles. They became lords over their own properties. And that's what the estate is. It is an incredible step back into history, into the Gilded Age. You're talking about when millionaires went on Titanic. And, you know, that kind of thing. And it reflects all of that. It is beautifully manicured. It is beautifully, all the furniture in there all reflects the Gilded Age. And it's so easy to get to. I live in Central Jersey. It only takes me an hour to get up there. And we take the parkway all the way up to the Tappan Zee Bridge. And then it's right off of the Tappan Zee Bridge. And then you've got Sleepy Hollow Cemetery there and all the other incredible places. You've got, you know, incredible houses. Washington Irving's house is there. All these incredible landmark places. And it's beautiful. The area is just gorgeous. So if you want to get a hold, it's Chad Hopkins on Facebook, HOPKINS, and the site is the Lyndhurst. All you got to do is Google Lyndhurst.org, and Saturday, Sharon Smyth Lentz will be there giving tours. There'll be tours during the day. There'll be tours at night. I'm not sure if her nighttime tour is good for young children. So if you're going to take young children, I think it would be better to take them during the day.
Yeah.
But again, go to their site. They're selling the tickets right on the site, and you can. It tells you to be there 20 minutes before the tour starts. So you've got to remember also you're going to park your car and you're going to meet, you know, at a location and all of that. So make sure you time yourself, because I'm sure a lot of people are going to be there and they're not going to be able to hold up tours, you know, if you're running late. I want to thank you so much for coming on tonight.
Yeah, I would just want to say one more thing. My day job, I am a musician. I'd like to say hi to my fellow bandmates, Andy Bob, Joey Salvia, Nick Bertling. We just put out our new album. We're the Bleecker Street Cowboys. Bleecker Street sounds like the street in New York, although it's spelled B-L-E-A-K-E-R. And you can download our album on iTunes and Amazon, and we're coming to an area real soon, so check us out on Facebook as well. And we're all Dark Shadows fans, and we all support Lyndhurst, so I just wanted to give a quick shout-out to my fellow bandmates and brothers, and I love them a lot. So.
Okay, cool. Maybe you could get me a track, and we'll play you on GameCon.
Yeah, once you come out to the show, Mo, you've been awesome. I've really enjoyed our time together.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Next week, we're running out of time, but next week we're going to have Gary Striner on. Gary was a sound tech for Roman, what's his name, George Romero, who filmed Night of the Living Dead, the original one. He also was one of the zombies, filled in for one of the zombies. And Gary's going to come up, and he's going to talk about the movie that pretty much started it for zombie movies, the new zombie movies, the Night of the Living Dead. He's going to talk about the movie, but he also has a cause. He's trying to save one of the buildings that is in the first scenes of the movie where they drive into the cemetery. One of the buildings is in danger of being demolished. He's trying to raise awareness of its historic importance. And so we're going to have Gary on to talk about that next week, and Night of the Living Dead and how it was shot and his part in it all. I think anybody who likes zombie movies knows George Romero kicked it into a whole nother gear when he made that movie. And then on the 30th, we're going to have RJ Jameson. She had to be rescheduled a few weeks ago. She's going to come on and talk about Barnabas and Company. It's a sort of an encyclopedia about the cult classic TV show. And then November 6th, I'm going to be in Ireland. I'll be thinking about all of you, but I'll be in Ireland seeing the family digs and everything. I want to thank everybody for listening. Pass our links around. We're on GameCon Radio. You can find my shows on YouTube, and you can find them on Podomatic. And with that, I love you all. Be safe, everybody. God bless you, and good night.
Somewhere over the rainbow, birds fly. Birds fly over the rainbow, while I can.
Thank you for visiting me at my lair. Mo Banshee's Lair is broadcast live on Tuesday evenings at 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Central, 8 p.m. Mountain, 7 p.m. Pacific, and in the UK, 3 a.m. Wednesday mornings on www.gameconradio.com. You can listen to our recent recordings on Podomatic/Mo Banshee. You can contact me at www.asylumsgate.com. Again, thank you for listening. God bless you and yours, and have a very cool day.